So now we're going to shift, and we're going to hear an amazing talk by a hardware lead at Google. She has, Jean Wang has a PhD in electrical engineering in photonics. She worked in the optical communications and then came to Google. She's the hardware lead on Google Glass. As a board member, I have Google Glass. I love it. It's so much more natural than a phone. And now you get to hear about how she did this. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. Smile. So I'm very happy to be here with you today. I'd like to share with you my glass journey. It's a three-part story that spans across multiple domains. And while it is yet unfinished, I hope you share my enthusiasm for what is yet to come. Before diving in, I'd actually like to float this number briefly and plant it in your minds. It has significance to me and the story. And in the meantime, please feel free to question the number base that I'm using. So glass, like many ideas, started as a blank canvas. As part of the initial team, we came into the project largely inexperienced in the field of head-mounted displays. Instead, we had the ability to divide and conquer through our ability to learn and adapt. While some of us focused on optics, like myself, others worked on cameras, sensor systems, electronics. And so we also came in with the fundamental belief that technology had ripened to the point where we could make a significant impact and create something of significant use. And that has led us into the discovery phase to find out just what it was that could be done, to basically minimize the barrier to information access and to make us connect with each other in terms of accessing our social sphere. As part of the discovery process, we looked at existing products in the mobile space and wanted to really understand where it was that we can make an impact in terms of form factor. For example, whether it was bulky and had to fit into our pocket or carry around a bag for it. Ease of access, whether we had to pull it out of our pocket or a bag to actually engage with it. And also ease of use, whether we were blocked when we were using the device, or whether we could look straight ahead and talk with people and not be distracted. So to push on these pain points, we did a number of technical experiments. Here's a helmet-mounted display that did not allow us to be hands-free or wires-free. And in the bottom, you can see here is an early optical experiment to help us understand the technical complexities in terms of how optics sizes actually impact the performance and the image quality. So with these considerations in mind, we dived into selecting components that we can use and make a viable solution. So in the vast array of options, we looked at what it was we could just reuse and customize, or was there something that we had to invent for ourselves? So we played around with a bunch of picoprojectors and projectors. We looked at optic components such as lenses and prisms, as well as interface devices, touchpads, microphones, speakers. And underpinning the whole system was electrical components and board design. So in this huge selection of choices and huge array of options, how do we down select? And so we filtered using two key criteria. One was power consumption, and the second was weight. So these two are basically factors in enabling us to first wear a system all day, and second, actually allow us to want to wear a system all day. And so we headed into the second phase of prototyping. Here are six example generations, oops, little slide mess up, of glass prototypes. Starting at the very top left, we took the lowest hanging fruit of simply putting mobile phones inside of the head. And a pico projector shining directly into the eye to provide the image. And so this was a bit bulky, as you can imagine. It came in at 167 grams. And we wisely decided that we could lighten the load by taking the mechanicals off the phone. And that's our second proto, shown right up there in the middle top. And so as you can see, over time, we shifted from using off-the-shelf components, such as safety shields and frames, into 3D printing our own frame. And that's shown here in the third. And you can also see that we migrated into making our own optical design and architecture, which is something we carry through today. And as you gradually evolve to the very end, you see that more and more we use customized components, and we look at making our own plastics and metals to get to where we are today, which is essentially the essence of what glass needs to be. This provides the core and provides a very minimalistic system that allows us to run around and be happy when we're playing with the system. And in addition to prototyping with the hardware, glass derives its use from an easy-to-follow UI. And this is, by definition, not actually easy to make. Along the way, we experimented with a number of different interaction concepts. For example, head gestures. And that recent SNL skit was not too far from a previous truth, if you've seen it. Also, we experimented with porting the keyboard functionality to the touchpad. And we found that it was a bit too complex, even when running in a predictive word mode. We also tuned the number of lines of text, the font, the size, to basically optimize for readability. So through all of these things, we found that minimalizing and stripping down to the very core allowed for the best use case and experience. We also found that minor head tilts and voice commands allowed us for hands-free experience, which is very important when we're busy dancing or riding that roller coaster. On the flip side, having the touchpad and the camera button allowed us for more quiet modes of interaction. So with hardware and software solutions converging into a viable state, the team naturally turns to the question of production. It is possible to manually tweak and baby one device to get it to be close to ideal in terms of cosmetics and functionality. However, we like to share glass more broadly. And so that, to us, quickly turns into the question of scale. How do we build not 1,000, 100,000, but upward towards a Google of devices? Layering and automation is key to this. And that means that not only do we have to build glass itself, but we have to build the infrastructure that builds glass. The floor space, the equipment, the whole kit and caboodle. And to add a bit more complexity, we'd like to honor individuality and human preferences. And that, to us, has meant color options. And that leads to color complexity. How do we make sure that on the device itself, part to part, the colors match? And how do we make sure that between devices, the colors match? So production requires the solutions to all these questions and beyond. Through these three phases of discovery, prototyping, and production, I have found that glass is both an innovation and a reinvention. By integrating highly compact and new components, we've been able to extend far beyond in the field of head-mounted displays, beyond the last several decades of individualized movie players, game consoles, and aircraft systems. On the other hand, I think that glass is a way in which we can examine and develop new fields, that we can push beyond and learn to be better connected to each other, as well as share perspective and have access to information. And all of this will allow us to better empathize as people and sympathize. So coming back to that number at the very beginning, it's been exactly, as of today, 1,111 days since I joined. And this is a picture I would not be able to take without glass. I am paragliding over Coronet Peak in New Zealand. And just by looking at it, I can recall what it was like to soar with the birds and to take in the beauty of the landscape. I've often been asked what the aha moments have been in the project thus far. And while I have a few, I'm more excited about what is yet to come. There is a first tier, for example, barcode, QR code scans, where we can get just-in-time reviews of movies, books, that menu trays we're just about to take, but we're not quite sure yet. Then there's also never getting lost and not bumping into things while you're looking at directions. And then there's a whole nother level. Recently, one of my colleagues exchanged his wedding vows while wearing the device, and I get goosebumps when I imagine him reliving that when he is old and gray and seeing the reflection of a future from his wife's eyes. And then there's also a physics instructor who recently toured CERN with the device. And he did a hangout back to his classroom in Michigan. And he was riding his bike down the tunnel of the Large Hadron Collider, showing his classroom just how cool it was while taking live questions on the spot. Then there's also another example where glass can mean life or death, that it can help you translate to a medical doctor in a foreign country that you're allergic to penicillin. So through this process, I think that there's just so much potential in what is yet to come, that in pushing towards a new perspective on information sharing and perspective sharing, we've come upon a new environment and what glass can engender. And when I have time to pause and think about how far we've come, I feel privileged to be part of such a dynamic team. Together, we're striving forth to bring forward this new perspective. And I count you as developers as part of this growing group. There's just so much potential and positive impact in keeping in the moment, where information is just at your fingertips and knowledge is a twinkle in your eye. And with that, I look forward to your aha moments. And we are back to discovery. Thanks, everyone.